I want to ask questions to you. You know, what questions? Okay, the question is, it is not a question actually, but I want to have a recap. So the question is that I would like you people to answer me. What are the steps to write a the cloud or your the conflict diagram? Who would like to tell me the first step? Shivram? Okay, you have already written conflict, right? So you can tell us the first step suddenly. So what is the first step?
Outline. I wrote a yes. First one is maybe the objective. Fix the objective. A?
No.
No.
Okay, anybody else?
Conflict. Write down. Sorry. Okay.
What? Come again?
Write down both the conflicts. Conflict.
No. Anybody else?
Write down a story first.
Correct. Write down the story. Now the story line. Okay, why it is important to have to write? Because it actually defines, you know, what you are going to do up with it. You can refer back to it, okay, to write the actual conflict. So, Mr. Sarabjit Singh, you are right. The first step is write the storyline. Now, what is the next step? Okay, Pratik, are you there?
Objective.
Okay, please put on your video and your the microphones. So please put them on so that we can converse. Shiva, Pratik, Vishal, please put it on.
Just a minute, sir.
Yeah. Anilji, let's see each other. It's good to see your faces rather than looking at the screen. So what is the second step?
The second step, we write the conflict, X and Y.
What is X and Y?
D and D minus.
D and D dash.
Oh, sorry, D and D dash. I'm sorry. D and D dash.
Okay. Good. Correct. That is the second step, right?
Yeah.
Then what?
Then we write the,
Hold on. No, I want somebody else to tell.
Okay.
Irshad? Okay, you are...
First to write the D and D. Hello. First is after writing the storyline, you have to write the D and D prime.
Right. After that?
After that, you have to write the need required to fulfill dash that D and D prime.
Correct. So that we consider B and C, right?
B and C, yeah.
Correct. Then what after that? Vibhuti?
Outcome.
What of
desired? Common goal.
Common goal, right. The objective that was there. Right? Yeah. Then what do you do? Shiva?
Yeah, after we have the common goal written, we can just recheck whether the want and the need of the opposite person, want of mine and the need of the opposite person, are they in jeopardy or not, to make sure it is right.
So no, you're jumping ahead. See, after you have written all A, B, C, D and D, right? You need to read it aloud.
Read it aloud. Okay.
In order to have A, I must have B. And in order to have B, I must have D. If you read it aloud, and if you read it in full sentences, okay, you can make it out whether it sounds good, sounds to your ear. You know, that actually tells us that no, this wording is not correct, or what I written that itself is not correct. So the next step is you have to read it aloud.
Excellent.
And then when you read it aloud, you have to read again part of D and not D. B and D project. You have to see that they are mutually exclusive. Both of them cannot coexist. You have to say that this and this cannot coexist. So if they can, or if they are not mutually exclusive, it will not sound correct to your ear. So that is the importance of, you know, reading aloud. Sounds good. Many of us quite often say, okay, what you say sounds good. What does it mean? That it meets your logic. So when you do that, we had to do what Shiva you said, that we had to check whether the D is blocking the need of C and D prime is blocking the need of B. If it is not, it means something is wrong. Some wording is wrong, or something that we have done, you know, is wrong. So we have to go back and check and refine it. We call it upgrade it or refine it till you read it over and over again and it sounds good and you are convinced that yes, this is the real conflict. These two things, D and D prime, cannot coexist and the needs are correct. And either needs are not in conflict, because we need both. And so they cannot be in conflict. Right? So this is what you have to check. Unless and until you check this, there is no point in going ahead. So this is the primary requirement of doing it. Right? Now let me run through my presentation. Yeah, so this is what, you know, in the box that we saw last time. At the bottom, there is a conflict. And on the sides, there are assumptions, and we have to make attempts to bring out those assumptions. So how do we do that? We ask, why is want D necessary to fulfill need B? Or complete the statement, in order to have need B, I must have want D because. And repeat this exercise for need C and want D also, D prime also. So this is how, you know, your diagram will get amended to some extent. And you will be adding a block showing that we will write that, okay, in order to fulfill B, I must have D because, and write the assumption. Now, the thing is that why these assumptions? When we say that, you know, this is understood, this is, when we say that this is understood, you should have known what we are referring to is the implicit assumption. But the other person with whom you are dealing may not know what you have in your mind. You also do not know what he has in his mind. So it's better to come out, and maybe it is a very obvious assumption, but it is worthwhile bringing it out. So the cloud is a simplified version to describe the reality that you are facing. And when we do that, since it is very simplified, we need to explain something. So that explanation, unless it comes in, it is in place, you know, we do not understand it correctly. And this explanation is called the underlying assumptions. These assumptions are why we believe that necessity relationship exists between these two entities. So, as we say, in order to have A or in order to have B, I must have D because. So, everything you say after because is an assumption. And assumptions could be bad, good, bad, or ugly. Typically, there are several assumptions under each arrow. Several. Remember, because sometimes we are just happy with just bring out one or two assumptions and say, oh, everything seems to be fine. But the other party has not understood everything. So try and bring as many assumptions as you can. Then challenge every assumption. You have to challenge in the sense that ask, you bring all the sarcasm that you have. And ask the question, really? So when you ask that question, you know, your mind will, who might tell you whether you somebody's some assumption is really valid or not. So if we, if we find an assumption which is not valid, what will happen? Now supposing there is an assumption between B and D. B is the necessity and D is the action that you are taking. And there is some assumption which is not valid. It would mean D is not required, right? Because we are doing D, because we assume our action is based on certain assumptions. And if one of those assumptions are not valid, then D may not be required. But at times, you know, it is not easy to find invalid assumption. So if we don't find an invalid assumption, we need to find one that we can make invalid by taking some action. Now, how do we do that? Well, we see the way how we can do that, but we have to somehow invalidate some assumption, and it will lead to change the situation in some way. In either case, we are searching to break the link between B and D or C and D prime. Somehow, if we are able to break that link by invalidating any assumption, the cloud will evaporate, the conflict will go away. So what will happen if we can negate an assumption? As we said just now, the cloud will evaporate. But in order to negate an assumption, we must introduce something that is new into reality. Now, if all the assumptions that we have discovered are valid, then we have to find something that is not existing today. But if we introduce that, it will change the reality. So these actions, that new action that we take to invalidate assumptions, are referred to as injections. So we call them as injections in our TOC terminology, and we say this star, we have D prime, that are opposite of each other, and injection is D star. Now this action may be completely new, or maybe some variation of D or D prime. So the idea is that as long as it is able to invalidate the assumption, it is good for us.
I have a question.
Yes.
In situations where the
it shows the how we can connect multiple problems along with some facts of life and arrive at what is our core conflict or core problem.
Okay.
So there is another tool if there are multiple problems and there is a lot of confusion.
We ask
people to write a storyline because then they become specific about a problem.
Okay.
But the case that you have explained, I feel that they are not able to talk about any one problem, but they are talking about series of problems.
Correct, Rajiv.
So we can use another tool for that. Okay.
Thank you.
And within that, again, you can use this tool once you zeroize on one conflict.
Sure.
Or multiple conflicts, they can handle. They can be handled separately. Okay.
Yeah. Thanks.
Okay. Thanks for a good question.
Mr. Rajiv, I have one clarification. I just like to explain something, and you just tell me if the way I'm thinking is right. Like, if somebody says that my problem is that I want everyone in the house to respect me, okay, and you ask him again, and he says I want everyone to respect me. I presume that if you keep on asking him the same question, then he'll probably end up saying that, okay, I don't need everyone respecting me. I want probably some stature or something. So could an answer to this be is that if you have an assumption, you keep on asking why till you get to the root of it. Is that what we are saying?
No, we are not talking about five-by tool. First of all, you're saying that, others should respect me. So you are demanding respect, you are not commanding respect. Respect has to be commanded.
Yes.
And you are expressing your wish. You are not expressing the conflict that you have. You may have lots of wishes. So that could be your objective. I want people to respect me. So you can start from the objective and go to the conflict, or start from the conflict and reach back to the objective.
Okay.
Any other question? Okay, so let me continue. Good. I like this kind of interaction. Otherwise, it becomes a monologue for me. Oh my God, what is this? Pig may fly even. This flying pig. Can you believe? You know, I never believed it. Okay, unless I saw one. Oh, I don't mean that I saw a real pig flying. But this is what we call when we come up with the ideas which we feel that it is impossible to do it. So why when these ideas come to us when we are trying to resolve a conflict? So what are the examples that we have seen often? I can say that we often say that there's a conflict between high inventory or low inventory, and I come with that injection that we can have high inventory and low inventory at the same time. The answer is your response could be impossible. You either have high inventory or you can have low inventory, but somehow there is an intuition in my mind that we can have it. So if I give that as an injection, what will happen? Okay, it could change some reality and some conflict may go away. Now when I made this injection, I had no clue how am I going to achieve that. But what Dr. Goldratt said, that he encourages this kind of out of the box or out of the blue kind of ideas, and then figure out if this can break this conflict, how best we can achieve it. And he has found answer to this question as to how we can have high inventory and low inventory at the same time. Now, it is a different application, so I cannot discuss it in detail now. Then, another injection that I can bring in, again, flying pig kind of injection. It cut the lead time to half. What do I mean by cut the lead time to half? What is lead time? It's the point from which the order is received in the factory till the order is fulfilled, is delivered. Now that lead time, I think it is substantial time, and I'm saying that the injection that I want to make is that cut the lead time into half. So I'm taking 3 weeks to deliver the order. I'm saying that do it in half of the time. Now again, the thing is that it is impossible. It has never happened. But as Dr. Goldratt said, today you don't have that clue. But if this is going to resolve your conflict, let us try and figure it out how to do that. And he has shown it. Again, it's a different application. You can find that in my books. But this is an application that has helped in reality. Now we have set up, and many times it takes hours together. And supposing somebody gives an injection that this particular setup is taking 2 hours and it's causing lots of problems, how about how about bringing it down to 2 minutes? Can we not do this setup on this machine in 2 minutes? People will laugh at it. It's stupid. You're a fool. This is impossible. But it could be possible. And if you have seen the TOC implementations or even Lean implementation, they had done that very successfully for many, many setups. In the car races, I think in one of my earlier sessions, I do not know how many of you attended that, I had shown a video where the car races, the car comes and they do a kind of fix servicing. They change the tires, fill in fuel and all that, and it goes out. How it used to happen in 1950, how much time it was taking and how much time or how many seconds it is taking today. So it is possible, but our mind is set that it can't be reduced. So this becomes a pig may even fly kind of injection, but today we don't know. But if this happens, it is going to evaporate some conflicts.
Rajiv, I want to share one reading that I've heard. I don't know whether it's a TOC application or not. Okay. In the US, there is this Southwest Airlines. So they are a low-cost airline, apparently. And there's a book also called, I think it's called Going Nuts, right? So what they were, as a typical airline turnaround time, like what you are giving an explanation, was 20 minutes or 30 minutes in that point of time. So these guys said, no, if we... As a low-cost airline, we make money only when we fly the aeroplane. So they went to a Formula One racing to see how these things are done. And correct. From 45 minutes industry average, they came down to some 15 minutes.
Correct. I was referring to that Formula One video that I had shown earlier. Mm-hmm. You know, but I couldn't recollect that name, so I was just talking about car racing. But it was that Formula One video. It is available on the net. You can search for it. But this example is right. Southwest has been doing a great job in their customer service by applying this for this kind of pick me even fly kind of ideas. You are right, Kavishiran. Thanks for that. Then if I say that we are having a problem in servicing our customers, they are not getting what they want and we have wrong products in the shops and all that. And if I say that my injection is that keep the products away from our customers. So the immediate reaction of the people will be what? Away from the customers means don't keep them, keep maximum inventory in retail shops. So I say yes, don't keep maximum inventory in retail shops. But keep it away. So this is madness. This will not work. Impossible. But this works. Dr. Goddard has shown that. So this also is a pygmy fly kind of injection.
So that
you are doing multiple projects. You are in multi project environment and projects are getting late and late and late. So I say that we want to finish our project early, right? So let us start them late. Again, everybody will look at me and say, is a stupid guy, doesn't know anything about projects. But if you look at the CCPM application, that is TOC's solution for project management, we actually start the projects late and we actually finish them before time. So this is the kind of injection that, you know, we say that pig may even fly. Then this is actually we had discussed in our earlier session that sell your products below the product cost. Now I think some of us are cost accountants and they will immediately raise an objection that if you sell something below your product cost, you are bound to incur loss. But we have shown it in our sessions on throughput accounting that we can actually make more money by selling our products below our product cost. So when this kind of injections come, you know, and we have no clue as to how to do this when we thought of this injection. But when we say that, yes, if this is going to help us, let us put all our energies, all our brains, all our creativity, and we can find that. And Dr. Goddard has given us enough of such solutions. It's only such injections are referred to as flying pig injections. If this is the case for you, do not despair. There are effective techniques for grounding a flying pig. So look for this kind of injections and then bring them into reality by using TOC methods. Now it's high time for us to have a look at a case. Now I'm calling it Storyline 2 because Storyline 1 was discussed last Sunday. It was about having the large batches versus small batches. Now today let us have a different kind of story. It is the story that we discussed last time. It was a conflict between a mother and a son. Son wanted a game, video game called Crank, and mother was not ready for that. So I will not go through everything because we all know. I hope you remember that, right? Do you remember or you want me to go through it again? Tell me.
We remember.
Okay, thank you. So we started with D and D prime, have the crack game. D prime, don't have the crack game. Then we found a need. John's need was have a fun and recognition. And his mother's need was not practice violent acts. So now we come to know from where they are coming from. Then we have identified the objective just to get along together at home. Then we read the cloud that John reads it. In order to get along at home, I must have fun and recognition. In order to have fun and recognition, I must have crack game. And his mother said, in order to get along at home, I must not practice violent act. And in order to not to do violent things, I must not have the crack game. This is how John has read this cloud. So it's simple that these two things are in okay real okay conflict, you cannot have the crack game and you cannot have the crack game at the same time. So the conflict is real. Yes.
One question. This just go to the previous slide. The second one is this his mother's interpretation or John's interpretation or reading of the
blog? No. He asked his mother why. Okay, what is your objective?
Okay.
And his mother's answer that he has recorded. If you are drawing a cloud conflict with someone else, you may write what you feel, but you have to check that this is what I written. Is this correct? Because he may have some other opinion. He may have some other need. So this need is expressed by his mother that, look, John, I don't want you to practice violent acts. That's why I'm not giving you this game.
So from the writer's perspective, we have to see both the sides.
Yes. Why are writers, whosoever is in conflict, they have to see both the sides. They must understand the other person's side. And they have to make sure that their side is represented correctly. Okay?
Yeah, okay.
So the conflict is real.
Yeah.
We cannot have both the things at the same time. Now, does one D block need C? Okay, what is D? Have the crack game. And what is C? Not practice violent act. So if you have it, you are bound to practice violent act. John is bound to practice. So it is blocking this need of his mother. Now D prime, not have the crack game. Is it blocking the John's need to have fun and recognition? Yes, it is blocking. It means the cloud has been defined correctly. Okay. Now, do you have any quick and acceptable solution? Now, this is a question to you. Tell me. Do you have any quick answer? Because, see, we are experts in solving problems, right? Okay. The boy is crying, shouting for his for this game, and mother is adamant, saying no. So how do we resolve? It's a very common kind of thing, right? Children keep on asking and parents keep on saying no. Then what happens typically? Either parents use their power and say nothing doing, so the child has to give in, and it is win-lose kind of situation. Or sometimes they surrender. Okay, you want it, go have it. So they surrender. So it is lose-win situation. And what we are looking for is win-win situation. So how can we find a win-win in this situation? Let us see that. Solution will not come from the God. You and me will have to find it out. So we follow the steps given by Dr. Goldratt. Bring out the assumptions. So what are the assumptions? So first, we ask John's mother, or John asks her, that, Mom, tell me, you are saying that in order to not practice violent acts, I must not have the crack game. What are your assumptions? So she says that there are many violent acts in crack. And if you play this game, you will be practicing violent acts, which I don't want. So these are her assumptions. Now John sits back and thinks of his own assumption, and he comes out with many. So what are his assumptions? He says, I have fun playing crack. He says, crack is the only video game having fun. He says, I only have fun when I'm playing video games. He says, I'm not getting recognition from my friends if I don't have it. And he says, there is no other way to have fun. So there are assumptions from his mother, assumptions from John. Now what? They have a dialogue. They discuss this assumption. So he says, hi, Mom. Hi, John. He says, Mom, after we had a look at your assumptions, I felt that they are valid and support your logic. Now, see what happens. When you see somebody says actions, we don't agree. John was not agreeing with her action of not giving him a video game. Now, when assumptions are brought out, he says, yes, I am able to see why you are saying that. And it is valid. And it supports your logic. So she asks him, okay, what do you think about your assumption, John? Now let us see what John has to say. So when I looked at my assumptions, I was not happy. He's very honest. all but the first one are not valid, and I'm not sure about the first one too. Why is it that? Okay, 1 minute. Before that, what were his other assumptions? We might have forgotten. So let me just quickly. The first assumption, let us keep aside. I have fun playing crack game. He said, other than the rest of them, I'm not worried. Crack is the only video game having fun. Why? There are lots of other video games that can give fun. So he says, so this is not valid. He puts a cross on this. Then he says, I only have fun when I'm playing video games. How come? Fun is there everywhere. Why you have to play only video games to have fun? So this is also, you can put a cross. Then he says, I am not getting recognition from my friends because I don't have this game. What nonsense. Recognition is not based on this video game. So this is also a cross here. And there is no other way to have fun. How could be? With you are so you know, addicted perhaps, or you are not thinking properly. So John agrees with that, and he removes all these assumptions for 2, 3, 4 and 5. Now he says, I'm not sure about the first assumption also. So what is that? Okay, let us see that. He says, I never played this game called Crack. So I don't know if I would really like it. I only seen the advertisement and it gives impression that it is exciting. So he said, I'm not sure that it will give me fun. It's the impression that I'm carrying. So he realizes that his assumptions are not valid. Now what? So he agrees. John agrees. So is this the end of the story? Not yet. Let's see. So she asks, so what do we do, John? He says, there are a couple of alternatives. I could give up by D because the logic is lousy, or I could find an alternate way to meet my need. Because his need is still there. It is not met. Right? See, we are saying that this action that he is demanding is not correct because his assumptions are not valid. But what about his need? His need is not met yet. So he says, I know you never like to give up anything. So what is your alternative? So he says, there is a new adventure game called Constraints that I would like to get. There's no violence, but lots of obstacles to overcome, and it claims to teach you logical thinking skills. So if one game is not good enough, you can always think of another game. Now I had asked you this question, you could have suggested that. But when we just look at the conflict that the child is asking for a particular game and parent is saying no, how to break it? Now there is a way. Bring out the assumption and it brings out the way. So she says, okay, it sounds interesting. Let me think about it. Right? Now, is this all? Is this a universal solution for this kind of problem? Because this problem is there almost in every house. There are differences of opinions, or there are fights between parents and children, and their children have some demands and that parents do not want to fulfill. So is this a universal solution? If your child is asking for a particular video game and you don't want to give him that, the answer is no, this is not universal. This is good for this particular problem. For your problem, for your conflict, there will not be any the universal solution. It is your creativity to identify the solution. But this method will provide you the way. It will put you on the path. But different people will come out with different solutions for the same problem that they are facing. Perhaps their needs could be different, or even if the needs are same, the solution, the injections that they might come up could be different. So there is your thoughts on this conflict. And what is my advice to John's mother is that there are violent acts outside the crack game also. How are you going to protect John from this? See, parents are highly protective. They want to show their children the ideal world. They are not willing to throw them out and make them face the outside world. So the question is that how long you are going to protect John from the violence happening outside? There could be a kind of violence even on a playground. So it is important that John learns to face violence. Now, how to do that? Okay, let his mother find out. Now, give the advice for John also. He wants to have fun, fine. But well, one does not need video games for having fun, right? There are several ways to have fun. So why can't we look out for that? Now see, parents often say this. During our days, you know, when we in our childhood, we used to play cricket as you are playing. Even we play what we used to call it gulli danda. But even if we played cricket, one of us had a bat and we somehow managed a ball and 10 of us played. Each one of us did not have the full kit, bats and gloves and helmet. And now children did all this. Why do you need all this? Well, the times have changed. Okay, whatever. But they... Okay, things are like that. But there are several ways to have the fun. That is the point that we have to tell John. And getting recognition from the friend, should it be dependent on what his parents give him? Or what he achieves, so that he gets some kind of recognition, some kind of respect from his friend. So that notion has to be corrected, that you have more and more things that will not bring you recognition. Your friends might become jealous of you, but that is not recognition. Recognition is, you can get recognition only if you achieve something, not what your parents give you. So these are the thoughts on this cloud. That, you know, there's no one way of resolving the cloud. There could be various ways. And out of the cloud, there could be several other learnings also. So this is one cloud that we discussed. Do you have any questions on this or any discussion points or any experience before I get into the next one? Okay. So let's move ahead. So let me take an example of what happens in corporate offices. There's some kind of politics and it is hidden. It's not very apparent. And there are some ego problems. There are some seniors and there are some juniors and they interfere and all that. So let's look at a project manager. Okay, this is a case of dilemma. Now, what is the difference between cloud, that is conflict, and dilemma? Conflict is between two people or two departments or two organizations. Dilemma is within oneself. I don't know whether I should do this or I should do that. I want to do this also, that also. So that is called dilemma. So here is an example of dilemma, which is based on what is happening in his working life. So this is my storyline. This is my problem statement. Bill wants to interfere with my work and challenge my role as a project manager. I am a project manager and Mary has been allocated as a resource to my project. She is from Bill's department, but Bill has no other involvement or responsibility for my project. He is not a sponsor and not a customer. I assigned some tasks to Mary, which she has not done yet. Now, this is my background. I am a project manager. Doing a project, amongst other resources, I have one resource called Mary, which has come from Bill's department. And apart from that, Bill has no connection whatsoever with my project. He's neither a sponsor nor a customer, nothing. But his resource, Mary, has not done the task that I assigned to her. So when I ask her why, she said that Bill prevented her from doing the task. He didn't agree with the approach we are taking. It's a very serious thing. Now I'm a project manager. Okay, Mary is an assistant given to me, resource given to me, and she's not doing the task because her boss, to whom she finally reports, has prevented her from doing, and with the comment that my approach is wrong. And Mary said that, why don't you go and talk to Bill, sort this out. Bill is very knowledgeable on this subject. He has done, you know, similar kind of projects in the past. He knows it quite well. But I don't want to go and see him. But Mary is my friend. Mary seems to be between a rock and hard place. I understand her position, because she is my friend, but she is now working for me and she is reporting to him. I am telling her to do one thing, and he is telling her not to do something. So what can I do? I thought of, you know, going to my boss, but Fred is my boss. But I know that he's afraid of, or he's kind of scared of Bill. And somehow I feel that he's not going to help me out in this. But still, I consider that as an option. Now you tell me, do you have any quick and acceptable solution to this dilemma that I have? Come on, try it out. Don't give up so easily. Okay, have you got a problem? I'm in office situation. I'm a project manager. I have one resource who is not doing the task because her boss said it is wrong. The approach is wrong. So how do I solve this? Should I go and confront with Bill? What do I do? There is no easy answer. There is no easy answer. We have to do little more work patiently. If I ask you this question, maybe if you are in that situation, spontaneously, okay, you might take some action and then repent also. You don't know. You don't want to repent. You are responsible. You are a responsible project manager. So how you'll go about it? Let us see. First of all, write down a list of actions that you could have considered or you would have liked to take in order to solve this problem. There could be multiple actions. Just think of what action that you would have liked to take and certain actions that you may be forced to take. And okay, how you write that? You will not write essay. You will not write storyline again. You will not write paragraphs. You will write single clear statements that are worded as actions. Now let us see. What are the various actions that I would like to take as a project manager of this project? One thing that comes to my mind, ignore the whole thing and get on with the project. This will get resolved on its own. See, many times we feel that if we neglect the problem, it gets solved. And sometimes we experience that also. And many times, you know, this is my personal experience. Me and my wife, many times I discuss, think ahead, and if this happens and that happens, then how we are going to do that? And we get worried on that, we think, and then that thing doesn't happen. So we often tell each other that, don't worry, it has not happened. There's a possibility, when it happens, we'll see. So we ignore, at least for the time being. Now here, you know, this is the thing that I as a project manager want to ignore the whole thing, get on with the project, something will happen. The second thing is that Fred is my boss, right? If I have some problem, it is I should be going to him. He's bound to help me. Why not? So that is another action that I can take. Third action is that, you know, write a small mail, small or big mail, but explain to him, because he says that our approach is not right. So let me pin down our approach, the approach that I'm taking to do this project, and he will understand. The second thing is that why to write this whole mail and all that? Just go and you see him, talk to him, or in other words, confront him. Or the other thing that I think, no, I don't want to confront. If I go, then there could be an argument and all that. So which at times there are some committee meetings that happen in the office, which both of us attend. So during that, just, you know, take out this topic with him and just, you know, get his support or try to do something like that. Or sometimes, you know, I get fed up. When Mary told me that she has not done the task because Bill has told me not to do. My first anger reaction was, you better go back to it. I don't want it. So these are the various actions, possible choices. There could be more, but this is, as a project manager, I listed down. There are some 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I think I listed enough. So these are the various choices available. Now, how do I go about them? Now, I have to classify these options. How do I classify them? There are two types of actions that are there. One is that I personally would prefer to do. And second is that I might be forced to do or pressured to do this kind of thing. So decide and mark this in appropriate column. Let us see the table in the next screen. See, these are the first column is possible actions. Then I'm marking it, whether it is a forced kind of action or it is a preferred action that I would like to take. So ignore the whole thing is a preferred action. I would like to do that. Or go to my boss, Fred. That is a preferred action. Write, build an email explaining an approach. It's kind of forced action to do. Because I might have to do that. So I don't want to really, but I might get forced. Go and see Bill myself. It could be another forced action. Otherwise, my problem may not get solved. Then another thing, approach Bill in a committee that we both attend. So that option looks okay for me. So it could be a preferred action. And the last option tell Mary to go back to me. And then let her go so that Bill will not know what I'm doing. I'll find some other resource. Our company is not small. I can always get a replacement. And I'll find and I will do this. So what I've done, I've taken all the possible actions that I thought, 6, and divided into 2. The action that I would prefer to do and the action that I might be forced to take. Now what? Now choose the action which you felt most forced to take or the one which was most expected of you in handling this issue. Right? Just choose that action and copy it into most forced action space in the next screen and then find out the opposite action of that. Okay, let us see that action. I am saying the most forced action is go and see Bill myself. That I feel that is the most forced action. And opposite to that is ignore the whole thing. So I don't have to go and see Bill and do that, right? So this is as a project manager, I feel somebody else might may feel something else. So he can choose that. But what he has to choose? He has to choose the actions which are opposite. One action is forced, the other action is preferred. And they are opposite to that, right? So earlier somebody was saying that we don't come to know what the conflict is, what the need is. This is one way of reaching that. Write the most forced action in the box label D. That becomes your D, and the opposite of that becomes D prime. So you have got a beginning to your cloud. At least you know that this is one action and this is the opposite of that. Both of them cannot coexist, right? It means I can't ignore the whole thing and I can't go to Bill and see him. So either I do this or do that. Right? Then write in box B the need that you would be satisfied by taking this action. Check the logic. Then write the action for C, the objective and all that. So you know that process. I did not read. So how the cloud looks like? Go and see Bill myself. Ignore the whole thing. They are opposite to each other. The need of ignoring the whole thing is that I must get on with my work. I don't have time. I can't waste time after Bill convincing him and all that. Let me ignore it and it will get sorted out by itself. In order to fight for resources, because the Mary is now my resource and she must do what I want. So I must fight for resource. So I must go and see Bill and talk to him. Now, what is the common objective? I'm able to deliver the project on time, right? So how do I read it? Does the flow of the words make sense? If not, we have to correct the wording. In order to able to deliver the project on time, I must fight for resources. In order to fight for resources, I must go and see Bill myself. Now on the other side, in order to able to deliver the project on time, I must get on with my work. And in order to get on with my work, I must ignore the whole thing. Then only I can get on my work. I can't get stuck here. So the cloud I read, looks okay. Now D and D prime, they are in conflict. I can do both the things. D jeopardizing C, go and see Bill myself and get on with my work. D jeopardizing that. And D prime jeopardizes the need B, that is ignore the whole thing and fight for resources. Now what next? We need to upgrade the cloud, upgrade or refine it to see that the wording is correct. Actually, when I read it, I do not know whether you sense it or not, but it didn't sound good to me. It didn't really sound, but I was not sure what is the right thing. But now we'll see what it is. So what are the guidelines? That entities are whole sentences. So when we read it as whole sentence. Then they do not contain internal causality, like words like because, due to, or in order to, and all that. This should be a statement without any causality. Then they are verbalized as action. D and D prime are actions. They are not thoughts. They are actions. And they are clear and direct. They are in clear and direct conflict. And B and C are verbalized as real positive needs. So these are the things that we have to check. If you feel that the logic in your Aurora cloud is not perfect, the cloud needs to be upgraded or refined. Check the places where the answers to the questions in the previous slide do not sound right and reword the entities. Right? So when you find that it is not sounding right, some refinement is required, please go and do that. Keep doing that till the logic sounds to be good. So this is the Aurora cloud that I read, right? Now the refinement or the upgrading that I'm doing, that I highlighted over here. Earlier I said able to deliver the project on time, which I changed, upgraded to deliver successful project. It's not a matter of only delivering on time. The project as a whole has to be successful. Then what I said, that in fight for resources. Now, fight for resources sounds a little too aggressive. So I said that I must secure resources. So which resources? I just identified. I'm talking about Miri. So in order to deliver a successful project, I must have secured resources. So sounds good. Now, on the other side, I changed the wording for C. What was the earlier wording? Get on with my work. Now, what does it mean, get on with my work? I was not very comfortable when I read that. So I said that it is just not getting on with the work that is there in my mind. But okay, in order to deliver a successful project, I must have respect for my position as the chosen project manager. My company has appointed me as the project manager for this position, and I had decided the approach, how to go about it. And accordingly, I assigned a task to Mary and others. So that has to be respected, whosoever it may be. So that is my need. As in, a project manager, I want to make it sure that this is my area, and these are my privileges, this is my job, and it has to be respected. And if that is the thing, well, I should not go and see the bill. But that wording also I changed. I said that ignore the whole thing. What does it mean? Ignore the whole thing. You mean ignore the whole project? No. Let me be specific. I want to say that not go and see Bill myself. Now, how does it look like? Go and see Bill myself versus not go and see Bill myself. The earlier cloud looked like go and see Bill myself versus ignore the whole thing. Now, it was not very, very informative about the conflict in that. But now the conflict is very clear. Then the needs are also very clear, and the goal is supporting the needs. So now we have correctly upgraded the cloud. So sometimes it is very easy to write a cloud. Sometimes you have to go through the process and read it again and again, refine it. See, you have to bring out what is there at the bottom of your heart. Your head may tell something, but in your heart, no. As a project manager, I felt insulted when Bill told Mary not to do the task that I assigned. He has not respected my position. Why can't he talk to me and tell me, give me advice if I need? So this is the respect that I was not getting. That was very agitating to me, to the extent that I was even saying that one of my actions was that, send back Mary. I don't want her. I'll manage without her. See, clouds have happened many times because of our emotions. And if we don't bring out the emotions, we will not be able to break the cloud. So now, does the flow of the words make sense? If not, correct the wording accordingly. In order to deliver a successful project, I must have secured resources, that is Mary, in order to have secured resources, I must go and see Bill myself. Then other side, in order to deliver a successful project, I must have respect for my position as the chosen project manager. And in order to have respect for my position as the chosen project manager, I must not go and see Bill myself. Now, this is the cloud that I'm facing. Now, I don't know how to solve it. Again, I'm checking conflicting. Yes, they are in conflict. Are they blocking the deed? Yes, I can't go and see Bill myself and still have the respect for my position. So I can't do that. So it is blocking it. And if not going to him will not help me to secure my resource. Mary is not doing the task. So it is blocking the needs, both the needs. Now, what is the solution?
Rajiv, you can just go back to the previous slide.
This one?
This is the slide.
Who is speaking?
Oh, this is Deepak Sethi here.
Yeah, Deepak. Sorry, I couldn't recognize you.
No. I actually have signed up on my daughter's account by mistake, so you may not be seeing my name.
Okay.
Now, what I wanted to say was that D, jeopardizing C, this does not seem to be very clear and tight. You know, meaning respect for my position as a chosen project manager. How does going and seeing Bill myself actually jeopardize it?
Yeah. Now let me explain. Yeah. I'm a project manager. I have been appointed by the company. My company has confidence in me that I'm able to do this project. I have enough knowledge of how to do it. Bill is an outside guy. He has just lent me a resource. And that's it. He has nothing to do with my project. So why should I go and see him? Then he will look down upon me. Dekho, aa gaya mere paas. He had to come to me. Why? I have self-respect. And if I don't respect myself, I can't expect others. So this is loaded with emotion of a person. It is not a logic that you apply in science, hard science.
Absolutely. So Rajiv, that's my point. And this is going back to your point about emotion.
Yeah.
He seems to be a very cerebral point that I must respect my position as the chosen project manager.
Yeah.
Whereas, really speaking, not going and seeing Bill is really more of an emotional response. Yeah. Why the hell can he be stopping me? So shouldn't C actually reflect more of the heart and therefore be a little bit more emotionally written? This is okay. I'm not saying that C is incorrect completely, but it perhaps is not capturing the feelings and the emotions Bill is going through, which is to say, what the hell, yeah? How can he stop me? Who's he to stop me? Meaning my ego is playing up, and that's a fact. Exactly. And half the time, ego is the reality.
Yeah. Now, here what I would say that, you know, many of us might have seen this kind of conflict in our life, or similar or somewhat different. Each one of us will express it differently. And I'm saying that this is one of the ways it got expressed. I'm not saying this is the ultimate way of expressing. No. Each one of us has a different way of expressing our own thoughts, our own reasoning. So this is one of the ways. It may not sound good to you, but it could sound good to the person who is going through this.
That's very fair. And we can stay and go forward. But it may be worthwhile to come back to this cloud and write it the emotional way also. Just as a matter of exercise, so that the learning is complete. So no issues with this, as I said.
Sure. So I'm just you're dwelling upon the surfacing underlying assumption. Cloud that we have written is a simplified version, so we need some explanation, and the underlying assumptions, if we bring them out, they explain to us as to why we believe I have to take these actions. So everything that I say after because is an assumption. So how to reveal, reveal the logic underlying the connection between need B and action D. In order to have B, I must have D because, and we complete it. Now let us take the first one. B and D connection, right? In order to have secured resources, I must go and see Bill myself, because this is the only way to get the person I need. Bill controls what Mary works on. I want a resource, I want Mary, so this is the only way. This is the assumption. Then there is one more assumption. Bill is blocking Mary from completing the task. So this is what Mary has said, that Bill has told me not to do it. But it is still an assumption, because I haven't spoken to Bill. Bill hasn't told me. There is one more assumption. Bill is aggravated by being ignored. Now, Bill is an experienced person. He has worked on similar projects, but I never went up to him to seek his advice. So these are my assumptions as a project manager for this B and D. Now let's look at another set of assumptions. Assumptions between C and D prime. The politics will undermine my position. In order to respect my position as the chosen project manager, I must not go and see Bill myself, because the politics will undermine my position. Because Bill is not my boss, sponsor, or customer. Why should I? Because going to see Bill would be a loss of face for me. So these are my assumptions here. Then what? Then copy the strongest two assumptions. Not all, only two assumptions. And the strongest from B, D, and D, and C and D prime. And put them into a table. And if you wish, you can also raise the assumptions on D and D prime by arrow setting. I cannot resolve this conflict because. So here I've done that. I'm saying that, okay, go to, I cannot resolve this conflict because I don't know how to handle difficult people. This is a self-realization for me. And I don't know what value there would be in meeting with Bill. Why? What is going to happen by meeting him? So these are the assumptions that I have under this cloud. Now I copy two of them that I feel as a project manager, as an individual, that these are the two important assumptions under B and D, C and D prime, and D and D prime. Now this is how I summarize them. Now what next? Now it's a time to get some injection. Here these assumptions as a project manager, as an individual, I feel that they are all valid. I cannot invalidate them directly. So I have to find some injection which will invalidate at least one of them. So what is injection? Just to recap, an injection is a condition that once it is in place, causes the assumption to no longer be relevant, right? So this change is called an injection. Okay, in order to have a good injection that breaks the cloud, it must fulfill needs of B and C. See, all along we are talking about breaking that cloud at D versus not D. See, the purpose of doing D and D prime is to meet these two needs of B and C. So if we are able to find some injection, not looking at what D and D prime is, but do something, take some action that could meet both the needs B and C. In that case, we don't need a D or D prime or both, and we may do something else. Because the idea is to meet the need. We are working to meet the need. We are not, you know, getting emotionally attached to the actions that we are determined. So that emotional attachment has to move from our actions to our needs. So again, those selected assumptions, we can write the injections. Now, this is the only way to get the person I need. Bill controls what Mary works on. So my injection could be, the chief executive directs Bill to release Mary to my project. Well, if he can direct, then Bill can do nothing about it. Now, is it possible? Can I go to chief executive? Do I have access? Please. Okay, pick me fine kind of injection. Fine. Bill is blocking Mary from completing the task. I said, Mary is transferred to work for me permanently. Let her not any connection with Bill, I may have to talk to HR and get it done. Perhaps it is possible, or perhaps again, it's like a pick, flying pick. Then I look at C and D prime assumptions. Bill is not my boss, or sponsor, or customer. So what is the injection for this assumption? I accept that Bill is a party to my project. Why? He's not my boss, he's not sponsor or customer, but I know that he's knowledgeable about the kind of project that I'm doing. So I accept him as a party and then deal with him like any other sponsor. There are 10 other sponsors there. He's not a sponsor, but maybe he's a well-wisher. I can convert him as my well-wisher, as an advisor. Why not? Then, okay, another assumption, going to see Bill would be a loss of face for me. This is the fear that I have. So for that, my injection could be, I put the project needs in front of my personal feelings. So how do we detach from our personal emotions or egos or feelings and focus on what we want to achieve? Then we look at the assumptions under D and D prime. I don't know how to handle difficult people. I get training on how to handle difficult negotiations. See, this is again the realization comes when people sit and think. See, when I'm talking to you and other peers and others, I position myself as if I'm the best. I know everything. I can do it. I show confidence. But inside me, I know my shortcoming. That I need this training. But now the situation has come, and I'm struggling to go to Bill or not to go to Bill and all that. Why? Because maybe I did this kind of training as to how to handle difficult negotiation. And the last assumption that I picked up, I don't know what value there would be in meeting with Bill. There may not be any value. So for that, my injection is, I listen carefully to what Bill has to offer to my project. Whether it will fetch any value or not, let me at least listen to him. Let me respect him. Let me show some respect to his knowledge. Who knows? I might get something which could be very useful. So, and believe me, what I have experienced, that listening to people gives you something every time. Like, to give you my personal example, that happened yesterday. Yesterday, there was a session, there was a webinar by Mr. Sunil Agarwal about this effective communication and all that. From there, I realized that I'm not connecting with you guys at all. I don't talk to you. I'm just looking at my screen and doing blah, blah, blah. So that's why, if you have noticed, this time I started with a dialogue with you. And in between, when you're talking, I close this screen and see. So I need to talk to you. It is not that I do a monologue. So every time we talk to someone, do something, there is a learning if you are willing to pick up. So this is the realization that as a project manager I'm getting. If you see, there are a few things for me. I'm seeking outside help. I'm saying that the chief executive, I'll request him, or I'll get very transferred somehow. Or, then I said, I'll accept him, this kind of compromising behavior. That, okay, let him also be there. I'll respect him and all that. And then I said, I put the project needs in front of my personal feeling. That's a very positive thing to do. And then introspection tells me that I don't know how to handle difficult negotiation. I need to learn that. I need to practice it. And then there's no harm in listening to some others. I may not do what he says, but what's the harm in listening? See the things, the state of mind where you are. So when I started with my problem, you might have seen anger that this guy is creating problem for me. From there, where I have reached? How I have reached? By correctly defining the cloud, by bringing out the assumption, and then thinking of injections. We don't think of assumptions, first of all. Even if we do, we don't think of inheriting them by taking some new actions. So this is the process that we have to internalize. It is not easy. It requires a practice. If you practice it, it is easy. If you don't practice it, it is difficult. So what is the next thing that you have to do? It is not over as yet. A preferred choice checked for win-win. copy A, B, and C. That is objective and B and C. Need A and need B. Then select one or more injections, a combination of that, and write it in injection box. Now what it is, let us see. I'm saying that in order to deliver a successful project, I must have secure resources. And on the other hand, in order to deliver a successful project, I must respect for my position as the chosen project manager. Right? And then I put the injection. Now, where's the conflict? Why I'm not thinking about the conflict? I'm saying that there are two actions that I need to take. They're in conflict. But what is my real thing? What I need to do? I need to meet this, both the needs of B and C, which will meet my objective. So is there any injection which will help me to meet the needs of B and C? Let's say, what could be that injection? I say, I put the project needs in front of my own feelings. Go and listen to what Bill has to offer me as the project manager and negotiate with him. Now, when you negotiate, you have an equal position. So that is the way I decided that I must care for my project more than my personal feeling. Yes, I may not like to go and see the Bill, to see Bill, but in order to meet my project needs, I want to deliver my project successfully. So if I if I need to meet Bill, I better go and meet him. Negotiate with him. What's the problem in negotiating? It's not war, right? So this is what finally I have come out with this injection. Now, as a third person, it may not be very convincing. May not be. If you are in this position, your assumptions could be different. Your injections could be different. And what you come out could also be different. So this is a one instance of this kind of office politics that we see. There are different things that happen in offices. There are different kind of dilemmas that they happen. There could be groupism and you are expected to be part of this group or that group. There could be many. You know it better. I don't need to tell you. But if we follow a particular method, particular way, we can have peace of mind. Otherwise, our mind could be pieces. So I'm saying I put the project needs in front of my own feelings and go and listen to what Bill has to offer me as a project manager and negotiate with him, because meeting Bill's needs is the basis for him meeting mine in relation to Mary. I am going with that selfish motive that I want Mary to do the work that I want her to do. So let me answer his queries. He may have some queries, right? So what's the harm? And the second thing is that showing respect to Bill means it is more likely that he will respect me. So in future, he will not give any instructions directly to Mary. He dare not, now that he has seen me and I have negotiated with him. So now this looks more respectable. So it strengthens when I say respect my position. I have to command respect. Today only I made that statement in answering somebody. I'm not going to demand respect from Bill, but I'm going to command with the respect. How? By going and facing him and negotiating with him, listening to him carefully, and then taking my own decision. He should feel that, yes, he is also a guy who knows. I'm not the only one who knows how to do this. So this is the way, some dilemmas can be resolved. There could be, every individual will have a different way. And it depends upon the individual whether they are able to successfully resolve this kind of dilemma or not. So this example has demonstrated in detail as to how cloud method works. The solution is not universal, and it will vary from person to person. The situations will be different. The solutions also will be different. So we often have more choices than we think. Somehow we restrict our thinking and say we have this or that. But no, there could be things beyond that. A decision is the choice between conflicting options, offering differing paradigms. You have to get into other person's paradigm. A problem is a blockage to progress caused by not resolving the conflicting option when they arose. So if I say, I ignore the thing, let it go, this is what happened, then it creates a problem. A problem is not totally one person's fault, but it could be both the parties. Now, before I go to the next storyline, any questions, any discussions? Deepak, you want to say something?
Rajiv, I have a question.
Yeah.
While dealing with senior executives, top shots, they already have a mental model about a problem.
Yeah.
And your window of discussion is quite small. Get them into that groove.
Right.
While you're dealing with senior CEOs and CTOs or executives of a organization, at what level of preparedness you should go with if it's an evaporating cloud also? So that, because they will not have so much time to discuss so many things.
Yeah.
How would you take it up in a real practical way?
Yeah. Here you can, it is not that you don't know what he's going to say. That you have some idea, some clue. So you prepare that cloud. Don't bring out the assumption. Just that cloud. And just show him, see, sir, this is what I'm seeing. Is this correct? Ask him that question. That this is what you want, sir. Ask him what this is what you want. Okay, let him say yes, this is the need and this is the action I want. Then you talk about yourself, but sir, this is also another need. Convince him on the need. Don't jump to the conflict directly. Once he agrees on the needs, he will see the conflict.
Okay.
But if he see what happens typically is that he is not aware of your needs. Hmm. He is at a different level. So he sees the organization at the height of 30,000 feet. And you are, say, at 10,000 feet, maybe even on the ground. So it is all for you to bridge that gap. He is aware that he doesn't know all the details. It's not that he doesn't know. But unless you show him, he will not know. So the thing is that, as we say, when you undergo your sales training or something in many years ago, we are taught that you have to follow yes, but method. You have to say yes and then say but. So don't be straightforward, say yes, but just write his friend. So he will be curious that what diagram he has written. That curiosity will bring him on your side. Then he will want to know more about it. Then you can talk about the technique also that you have learned and you are practicing. Then he will get interested in that and he will invite me to teach him and his organization. Right? Okay, any other thing? Deepak, you wanted to say something?
No, I think this is a very good example. And to the list of things that you have said, as you correctly pointed out, that when you see the conflict, it takes away the emotion and you get the clarity of the real issue. Because the conflict is in two actions and not in concepts and thoughts.
Yeah, see, if you find, one minute, sorry to interrupt you.
Sure.
If you find a conflict in two needs, it means something is wrong. Your needs are not needs, they are in conflict. So you have to find a need behind that. See, there is an objective and there are two needs. If these two needs are in conflict, it means there are some other needs. And these are the actions. So needs cannot be in conflict. Then this is not the right thing that we are doing. Please go ahead, Deepak. Sorry.
No, that's absolutely fine. And what you said is very valid. So I think that's the first thing that comes through. And then the second thing is, when you said any easy solution, and I think the best of us will get stumped, especially in our own situation, because the emotion is so much clouding that we'll either not be able to come up with anything constructive or what we come up with is going to be ego-led, emotion-led, and may not be the best solution per se.
Yes.
And therefore, this process again demonstrates that this brings thinking at the level of pure rational logic thinking and keep the emotions distortions away. And therefore, this is a very, very interesting example. This,
yeah.
The other example was also very good, the crag example that you gave, Rajiv.
Yeah.
Because, it just shows the weakness of the compromise method. Because yeah. in a normal thing, if you said if the mother gave in to crack, kya ho gaya, or if the boy also kind of dropped his demand, kya ho gaya. But just the discussion actually threw up two very basic issues. And I thought that was very good. And that is the power of a win-win, and that is the power of applying thinking, and evaporating cloud is a very powerful tool for that, which is to say that the mother should have become, like you said, the mother should become conscious to the fact that a real need is to bring him up right so that he is not, he's able to deal with violence in a mature manner.
Right.
And now she could actually follow up with many, many steps to do that, not just prevent the game.
Exactly. Yeah. See,
just one last thing, and it also provides to the young kid, John, that playing crag was not the only solution. He has bigger things that he can do, etc. So what I'm trying to say is that the gains go much beyond solving the immediate conflict that you start solving. Both are solved, ho hi jayegi. But you will actually in the process get much, much better value by following this process. So I'm making a case for this process.
Yes, good. Here I would like to draw your attention that what Deepak said, when you draw a proper cloud and assumptions and injection, you come up with several things that you will want to do. Now look at this cloud. As a project manager, I realized that I need to undergo training for negotiating skills. I got that realization. Also, it made me brave to go and negotiate with Bill. See, my boss Fred is afraid of Bill. He's scared of Bill. I know he will not go to him. Now, I have gathered that courage and say, okay, I'll go and discuss with him. First, I said, I'll just listen to him. Now, I'm saying I will negotiate with him. So, there are more than one thing that come up which takes you forward. Now, okay, there is one cloud that we are going to see shortly. We'll throw up even more, many more things that we will want to do than just looking at one small cloud. One cloud will throw up the action that you'll be amazed. Oh my God, I can do this, do that, and do that. So let's get back to it. If there are no more questions.
I think, Rajiv, we should ask for any more comments because I think the group, they may have, it's a very powerful thing. They should get some more comments, I think.
Yeah, I think please feel free to say. I'm only worried about time. If you don't mind extending, then it's okay. It won't be over by 12:30, that is for sure.
So, Rajiv, how do you segregate between picks can fly and injections?
We don't have to worry about it. Okay, fix is that you can do it. Flying is you have no clue how to do it.
Okay, it's okay.
It's a flying pick. If a pick flies, it will fly.
Okay.
There is a conflict between increase the price versus decrease the price. That is there in almost every organization. So let's jump into it and see what we can do. See, put yourself in the position of a new management trainee in a company. You have just joined, you hardly learn about the company and what products and all that. And you are assigned to a team that is expected to adjust the sales price of the company's product. So at first you feel out of place, how can I contribute? But okay, I've been asked, so I'll join. And what you think that is a matter, a simple matter, what's a big thing? Let production people tell what is the cost. Let finance people say, how much margin we need on that, add that profit element, and that is the price. But when I entered that meeting room, I found a team as production people, finance people, marketing people, sales people. And to that, I am also added. And the discussion started, and early on, it was clear that there is a conflict. Everyone wants to increase the profit of the company. There's no doubt about it. Everyone wants it. But they all have different ways of doing it, and their ways are not exactly complementing each other. No? There's no dispute that we want to increase the profit. But as a production manager, I may think of one way. As a sales manager, somebody else thinks of another way. And then there is a conflict. So let us see that. On one hand, sales demands lower prices so they can sell more volume. Very clear problem. Finance insists, no. You increase the price so that they can increase their margins. And marketing says something else. They say that they can't create sales without offering more value. Improve your product, give more features. or dramatically reduce the prices, then we find a different market segment for that. So as a new person, you are amazed with these things you have never thought of. So you are trying to identify business issues and trying to understand what the conflict is. So we are saying that we are a volume-based business. 1 minute. We are volume-based business. We must lower the price to get the volumes. And we can't afford to lower the price when our profit margins are so low. So there seems to be a clear conflict in your mind. So do you have any quick and acceptable solution? Please, guys, you have learned so much. You are so increase the sales price versus decrease the sales price. So in order to increase the profit margin, we must decrease the sales price. We are saying increase the profit margin, we must increase the sales price. So okay, margin becomes higher. And in order to increase sales volume, we must decrease the sales price. Then okay, more and more customers will buy. And our common objective is to make more money. And in order to make more money, we need this B and we need also C. So we want to increase the profit margin and also we want to increase sales. Both the things are required. But the actions that are required are opposite. So we are in a fix. Now, confirm. Either D and D prime are in conflict. They should be in conflict, otherwise our diagram is not correct. So increase the sales price versus decrease the sales price. Yes, they are in conflict. Do B and C conflict? No, they should not. Increase the profit margin versus increase sales volume. They are not in conflict. That is what we discussed some time ago. In a well-formed cloud, the existence of D jeopardizes the achievement of C. Now, increase the sales price, whether it will jeopardize, increase the sales volume? Likely, because you might lose some customers because there could be a competitor who is giving it up it at lower price. Then let us look at D prime. Decrease the sales price, whether it will block the need of increase the margin, profit margin. Yes, if you decrease the price, your margin goes down. Right? So the existence of D prime jeopardizes the achievement of D. So what do we do? Now we are set for discussion. This is the cloud in front of all of us. And the one person says, we have a good conflict, but I'm not sure how to resolve it. Now here you are. You are a new person, so you ask some basic questions. You say, I need a better understanding of needed parts. It is higher margin and higher volume. What do you mean by that? Somebody answers. Well, and did you say, first tell me, what is margin? First of all, I don't understand. So everyone else thinks that this fellow is stupid. He's asking what is margin? Okay, they are say that he's a new guy, but an MBA in management training, and he doesn't know what is margin. Okay, so let us answer it. So the fellow sitting next to you said, margin is sales price minus cost to produce. So you immediately throw another question. What is cost to produce? Great stupid question, but people are nice. So they answer you, the cost to produce is equal to portion of fixed cost plus variable cost. Your questions don't end there. So you ask, what is fixed cost? So the other fellow answers, fixed costs are costs not directly associated with a product like your salary, electricity, depreciation, property expenses, and so on. These are the fixed costs. And our fixed cost wouldn't go down much if we produce less. So he gave example and he gave a kind of rule that it has got nothing to do with, how much we produce or sell. This cost would remain more or less same. So we call them fixed costs. All right. And what are the variable costs? You are not, you are stopping asking questions. You keep on asking the same questions. What are variable costs? Then this guy, very kind-hearted person, he tells you, young man, variable costs are generally material costs and any other costs we can attach to each product. Directly variable, if we produce more, we spend more. If we produce less, we spend less. For example, good example is the raw material. Now what? Now you say that somebody says to they get back to the discussion. They say that to make more profit, we need higher margins. To get higher margins, we need to raise price. No? He's advocating his side. But why can't we also change the margin just by changing the way we account for our costs? Now, this is a very loaded statement. Some of you will not understand, but those who are with me in the training that I conducted on throughput accounting, you will find answer to that. What do you mean by changing the way we account for our costs? Then the other person says that to make more profit, we need higher volumes. He's presenting his case. To get higher volumes, we need to lower the price. But then this guy points out, but it is also possible that we might lower the price, but not get enough volume to make positive difference. Just because you have dropped the price doesn't mean that people are just waiting outside to grab your product. It may not make enough. It may increase sales to some extent, but I'm not sure whether it will make any positive difference or not. That we have to wait. So now what is the solution? So solution is will not come directly unless we bring out the assumption. So read the cloud from left to right. Say answer because. So I think I did not repeat this. You know all this very well. So this is the cloud, and we start bringing on assumptions. So we say in order to make more money, we must increase the profit margin because our variable cost plus the proportion of fixed cost are too high. So what he is saying that our margins are low, in short he is saying, so we need to increase it. So the assumption is that our margins are low. Now let us look at the other arrow. In order to make more money, we must increase sales volume because, we go from B to C. Okay, in order to increase the profit margin, we must increase the sales price because the only way to increase profit margin is to increase sales price. Now, here's a tip. Whenever somebody says the only way, just doubt, just suspect the question, that kind of assumption. Because the world is great, you are highly creative people, and there can always be more than one way, you know, to do that. So that is another assumption. Then we come on this side. In order to make more money, we must increase the sales volume because additional sales means additional profit. So this is another assumption. Then we say in order to increase sales volume, we must decrease the sales price. But no one will buy more unless we lower the price. Then there is a conflict. We say that increase the sales price and decrease the sales price are in conflict. They are mutually exclusive. They can't be together because we can't both lower and raise the price at the same time. So these are the assumptions that we have brought out. Now the next step is let us challenge this assumption. How do we challenge? We take the first one. Our variable cost plus the proportion of fixed costs are too high. We invalidate this assumption and say that we reevaluate the way we account our product cost. We take a new view. Now, cost accounting people have this concept of product cost, and TOC challenges this. Those who attended my session on throughput accounting, we have dwelt a lot on this. So, unfortunately, some of you have missed that. So you cannot get this, but there is a different way of taking decisions. So if we do away, in fact, we call it that it is a mathematical phantom. Product cost is nothing but mathematical phantom, and we have elaborated that in my previous sessions. So we invalidate this assumption by saying that we reevaluate the way we account our product cost, so we don't have product cost at all, and have a new way. We talk about throughput. The throughput, okay, the way we mean it in TOC. Then we challenge the other assumption. Additional sales means additional profits. We negate that and we say that we make sure any reduction in sales price actually increases profits. So there could be a way, again, this is a very loaded thing. It is a loaded injection. It is a pick me a fly kind of thing. That we make sure that we reduce the price and still increase the profit. At this juncture, I may not have answer, but TOC has a solution which actually shows you that by reducing the price, you can actually increase your profits. Then we look at the next assumption between B and D. The only way to increase profit margin is to increase sales price. We challenge even that, and we negate even that, and we say, we segment our market to sell a small portion of our product at a low price, increase the volume without lowering the price for all. Now, by itself, it's a huge topic about segmenting a market. If you have read Dr. Goldratt's book, It's Not Luck, there is a story about this. But just think of this. Supposing this phone that I use is costing, say, $20. And I have lots of stock of this. So I may go to a market where it will not compete. It is a segmented market. It's a niche market where I can sell it at a lower price and still I can make a lot of money. Anyway, I'm not able to sell in this market. So there are ways and means, and there are precautions and some action, but it is possible. So the only way that we say to increase profit margins to increase sales price is wrong. There are multiple ways, more than one way. So we have negated even that assumption. Then we look at the assumption between C and D. In order to increase sales volume, we must decrease the sales price, because no one will buy more unless we lower the price. We challenge this assumption and find an injection which will negate this. So what it will say? We find our customers' real need and meet that. They will be glad to pay even an increased price. We always think about in a limited, close mind and don't go beyond that. So it is not always necessary to reduce the price to sell more. If you are able to meet real need of the customer, have some more features which are useful, it is possible. Then, we look at the conflict that increase the sales price and decrease the sales price cannot both lower the price and increase the price. So we have negated that. And what we say? We create a minor difference in our product at little expense to us that creates a value difference to our customer. The example is home hammer versus craftsman hammer. This is a small difference, but there are two different market segments and it can have different kind of values. So in one market, the same product with some difference can have lower price, other market can have higher price. So these are the various, now this one small cloud has shows up how many options. The first option we talk about, reevaluate the way we account our product cost. Do away with product cost. Go for throughput accounting, that is the mistake. Reduction in sales price may actually increase the profit. This goes well with this creating a minor difference, okay, in our product, or finding a market segment where we can sell a small portion, but we can make a quick buck. Okay? Then we find our customers' real value. So many actions it has thrown up. So we are taking ourselves, our company, at a different level, and we no more fight between whether to increase the price or not, but we take these other actions, and then we find that this cloud doesn't exist at all. Because all the assumptions that we have identified, we are able to produce injections which will invalidate this assumption. So this cloud is really not required. So this is the power of this tool. This is the power of TOC. That, you know, I think Einstein has said that if you have created a problem at a particular level and you are not able to solve it at that level, you have to go to a higher level and solve it. So this is that higher level that you need to go and take your company and solve that problem. Now, if we do this action, do we really need to debate whether to increase the price or decrease the price? We don't really need to. So this is the power that I wanted to show. Any questions?
Yeah, Rajiv, so you had these injections, and these injections will be broken into activities, as you said earlier, to figure out which injection. So how would I convince anybody that that injection would work?
Don't convince on the injection. So we tell him that, but be honest, say that I don't know how this will work. This is a new thought that came to my mind. Okay. This is, I admit that what you are saying is impossible today. I don't know. It is like, you know, okay, making the pig fly. But supposing if this particular pig flies, will you have any problem? Just suppose, just imagine. Imagine that you are a child. And child, see, the children's imagination is much broader than us. We go on narrowing it. So take him to his childhood. Imagine this is there. If he agrees that yeah, if this can be done, then there is no conflict. Fine. Then let's keep our conflict aside. Let's brainstorm how we can implement this so that we don't have conflict. Then both of you are, it is not whether you versus him, but both of you versus the problem, or rather trying to find out how this injection can work. Two people, two genius people like you work together, you can make wonders.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, anybody else? Tell me, guys, come on. No questions. Okay, fine. Now the question is, oh my God, it's such an elaborate process. I had to go through all those things before I could resolve, and then also, I'm not sure whether I have defined correctly or not, whether I brought out all the assumptions or not, whether they have, some of them are really invalid or not, whether I can find injections or not. Is it always such an elaborate process? No, not necessarily. Not necessarily. Just look at a small example. Problem is big, but solved in a minute like this. We know that in order to manage production effectively, we must produce a lot, right? And in order to produce a lot, we must increase work in progress. And on the other hand, in order to manage production effectively, we must control the cost and delivery. They should be in control. And in order to have delivery and cost under control, we must decrease the work in progress. No, I'm not debating in the meaning, because if you are not working the factory, not seen the factory environment or something, you may not really be convinced on this. But this is a dilemma most of the operations people are facing. So this is in conflict, that increase this WIP and decrease WIP is the real conflict. This side could be, needs could be different. Okay. Now we can just quickly come up with injection here, and assumption is that we can't both increase and WIP and decrease WIP at the same time, right? Yeah, we can't. The pig may fly assumption, injection is that. And actually, it is not pig may fly, pig may fly. Put a large inventory where it is needed and low inventory everywhere else. Now, where to put, where it is needed? Do I answer to that question? No, I don't have. So where do I lower it? Come on. My question to you is, if we can achieve this, if we can identify the place where we need more inventory, and we can identify the places where we need lower inventory, can this work? Can we negate this assumption that we can't have both increase WIP and decrease WIP? You'll say if, but if you can identify, then yes. Then actually TOC has solved this problem. It's the application, TOC's application for production. We call it DBR. and it shows where to put more inventory and where not to put more inventory. So you can have cloud, just write it on a piece of paper, ask for one assumption. If that assumption is invalid, the cloud, okay, the cloud is gone. Every time the injection did not be that difficult. Or when, so simply when you write it, okay, the person will realize that what he is doing is not really in conflict. So it may go away. So there are three levels of difficulty in solving it. The other one is you can draw the cloud in your head. You don't even need pen and pencil and resolve it. And it happens. Huh? I have personally tried that. Because when I'm traveling something and some conflict comes in my mind, it is every time not possible for me to reach out by pen and pad and write. So I think of it in my head. And there is level one type of cloud. Level two is that just write it down on a piece of paper and it will resolve it. Like when you write it down, you see, oh, this is not really in conflict. Huh? I thought it is in conflict, but it's gone. Or just read it aloud and you will change the wording and you will come up with something else which is not in conflict. Then if it is really a conflict, try bringing out the assumption and it will go away. That you will realize that some of these assumptions are not valid. Remember the John's case. He had some five assumptions which otherwise in his mind were valid. But when he brought them out, wrote them down, read it, he realized that they are not valid. It takes that effort to do it when you are in a difficult situation. A simple cloud, you can do it in your head and go ahead. So for a cloud to work, you must have a mutual or common objective. If there is no common objective, this cloud will not work. The biggest example is, if two countries are fighting on a piece of land, this cloud will not work because they don't have any common objective. Then for the cloud to work, what you need is an understanding of what you want, what other person wants, why you want what you want, and why the other person wants what he or she wants. Now, it may not be crystal clear in your mind when you start. But when you start, when you ask this, why I want this so much, then you know why. Then you can write that down. But you should have that understanding. It may be, tacit knowledge that you have, but it has to be there. As a third person, if you give me a cloud, I may not be able to, if you give me a conflict, D and D prime. In many cases, I may not be able to define the needs. I'm not in that situation. I never experienced that. So I have to ask the people who are in that situation, that is why they are doing what they are doing. Right? Then you need an opportunity to present the cloud. If the other party is not on talking terms, you may create a great cloud, but if you don't have that opportunity to present, then it is not going to work. If you, it is like winking at a girl in the dark. You know what is in your mind, but she doesn't know, right? So it is like that. So you have to have that opportunity, and not only present the cloud, you should get a chance to surface the assumptions and then challenge them. So this is what is really needed, and then successful result from finding one or more erroneous assumptions, you are able to find that. And finding a common solution. If you are not able to say all the assumptions are right, then finding a common solution or an injection that meets the needs of both the sides. I've talked about needs. Assumptions are many times invalidate the wants, right? They are no longer required. But if you bring an injection which could meet both the needs, so this is what is needed for the cloud to work.
Rajiv?
Yes?
Just one thing, and you can ratify what I'm saying is right. Just go back to the earlier slide.
This one?
Yeah. Your last slide says, success results from the following. You find one or more erroneous assumptions. Yeah. I just want to qualify this term. It's right, but I just want to qualify, and the qualification is that by itself, the way things stand in the current reality, that assumption is likely to be valid. The idea is that you can actually make it invalid by some intervention, which is what you're calling as an injection. So this is not to say that you made a wrong assumption to begin with. It means that the assumption is valid now, but it is not rock solid, and you can change it with some other intervention, which is the whole philosophy of the cloud solving method.
No. Sorry, here I would like to clarify two things. One is that when we look at the assumption and we challenge it, it may turn out to be invalid by itself. We didn't know it before.
Sure.
If it turns out, then there is no cloud. Then you don't need that action. But if it is valid, then and only then we think of some injection which will invalidate one of the assumptions, or it will need somehow meet the needs of both the sides.
So I'm taking that example where you've done the first reading and there is no invalid assumption. The cloud is standing.
Yeah.
And then when you say there is an erroneous assumption, what it means is there is an assumption which is valid today but can be made invalid is the point. If it was invalid to begin with, then in any case, there was no cloud and there is no problem. So we are taking that possibility out. I was talking about when you have agreed that there is a genuine cloud because the current assumptions are valid.
No. We say the cloud is genuine. Before we bring out the assumption, when all the five parts are, they sound good, D and D prime are in conflict, and D is blocking C and D prime is blocking B, then the cloud is fine. We are agreed on the cloud. Then we bring out the assumption. So this is highly volatile thing. We do not know how many assumptions are there, which ones are valid, which ones are not valid. We are open to discussion. See, this brings us both the parties, make them open to discuss. So when we define the assumption at that time, we may realize that some assumption is not valid. Till that time, I think my assumptions are right. But I don't know what my assumptions are because I have not verbalized them. They are there at the back of my mind. This tool, this method has forced me to bring it in the front, to write it, verbalize it correctly. And then when I say, this is not right. You know, there's a difference in that. And when I invalidate some assumption, meaning I come up with some action, if that action is in place, then this assumption is wrong. It's not. It will become invalid. Action is not there. But if we take this action, then this assumption will become invalid.
That is exactly the point I'm making.
Okay.
So we are saying the same thing. That is exactly what I'm saying, that great. By itself the thing is valid. It's this action which will make it invalid, and that is it.
Yes. Yeah. Correct.